Welcome back. In this mini lecture, we'll look at service mapping. Service mapping can be used as a process for understanding a service. Service mapping can provide you with three things. Firstly, the current state, a reflection on the service you provide today, putting you on the path to assess and monitor how your organization is delivering with the current people, systems, and processes. Secondly, the future state, a vision of the service your organization wants to be providing. Reflect business strategies, customer needs, and innovation of service delivery. And thirdly, the roadmap, which means designing for the transition, how service delivery and customer experience can shift and be supported, and putting your organization on a pathway from the current state to the future state. Service mapping visualizes both the artifact and the process. Services need to be mapped in a way that so everybody would actually understand the process of providing services in a unified way all through the organization. This needs to be done by using language that is understood and agreed upon. This is necessary for evaluating the benefits and problems that are associated with the service. It is also necessary for connecting organization strategy and goals with the service itself. Service maps try to answer the following questions. How is the service set up currently? Who are the stakeholders and what are their roles? Who are responsible for functional processes? How does the legal framework look like? When is the service provided? When are the deadlines for providing services? And what are the service channels? How can organizations use service maps? Firstly, by auditing what is the situation today? What are the actualities, efficacy of delivery, successes and problems? Then putting down the visions. What are the aspiration strategies, focus, common purpose, and reality? And lastly, road mapping. How are we getting there? Designing transitions, dependencies, progress, illustrations, and breaking down the work. Organizations should ask, do you know where a service sits within the larger service ecosystem? And write down all you know. What do you need? How are you going to get there? Do you know where do you want to go to? What can you do today to get there? And lastly, organizations should also be sharing information and experiences as they go along. The power of service mapping is its ability to bring teams together around a singular focus. We can scribble down the process of service mapping. We first start by identifying the team, as building a service map requires some really thorough knowledge of the target service. Even in smaller environments, services can be very complex, so it's best to approach building service maps as a team effort, since it's unlikely one person will possess all the information needed to build a complete and accurate map. Then we define the mapping template. Drawing or mind mapping software is well suited for building service maps. When starting a service mapping initiative, it's important to establish some standards to ensure consistency among all maps. People reading maps will have an easier time interpreting them if all maps follow a common form. Next comes the point of determining the appropriate level of resolution. The level of resolution for a service map refers to the amount of detail featured. Determining the most appropriate level of resolution is driven by considering the potential uses of the map and therefore how much detail will be needed to support those uses. Maps with less detail are easier to build and maintain. They are best for low urgency planning and decision making purposes where users need basic orientation on major service components and dependencies. Maps with more detail are more valuable, but they are also more challenging to build and maintain. They are more useful in high urgency activities like incident diagnosis. Determining the best resolution level for a given service map requires consideration of the likely audiences and users of the service map and the ways in which they will apply it. Then comes the part where we are selecting services for mapping. Service selection depends on the maturity of services and service management processes in the organization. The idea is to begin mapping at the very top of the service supply chain and to then progress downward. This approach will highlight the many downstream services that are also candidates for mapping. In the absence of a true service portfolio, it's typically best to begin mapping with organizations' most stable and mature services, because these are likely the clearest. It's important to note that mapping services is not the same as defining them. Mapping services can be a useful technique within an overall service cataloging program, but a set of service maps is not a substitute for a service catalog. Mapping evolving or vaguely defined services will probably be challenging, although it may help foster constructive discussions and mutual understanding about service structure, requirements, and parameters. Next, we are gathering data and drawing the actual service maps. Drawing the service map is best done iteratively. The first iteration can be rough and will help the team begin to visualize the service components. Successive iterations will refine the map. The role of the architect in this stage is to organize the proper participants and draw the map in accordance with established standards. At the end of each iteration, the architect and team need to evaluate the map and decide if it's complete. This is a subjective decision that should consider the following questions. Does the map reflect all known components in each stream? Has everything been identified? Are all components accurate? Are they named in accordance with the established standard? Are components accurate? Are they named in accordance with the established standard? Is there enough detail to satisfy the anticipated uses of the map? After that, we have to also establish service relationships where we illustrate how services are related to one another. One approach is to create a dependency matrix, or even another way of doing this is to hyperlink the maps to each other. In any case, all relevant documents and related materials must be stored in a suitable location accessible to all potential users. And lastly, we have to maintain the service maps. Because services evolve over time, service maps need to be updated periodically to ensure their accuracy. It is entirely possible that the organization itself changes over time, and therefore the teams responsible for the service maps and components change as well. Each map should be assigned an owner that keeps a regular review of each service map. It's advisable to make service map updates a required deliverable in the change management process. As authorized changes are implemented, corresponding service maps are updated. Service maps should be versioned, and any changes to them should be logged in accordance with organizational document management system and standards. Thank you for listening, and stay tuned for the next mini lecture.